Bandit's tail was between his legs and curled up under his belly. I looked down. My dog's eyes were wide with fear, and his teeth were bared. We both waited to see what it was. Dear Buckeye Bigfoot, Nance, and Sasquatch, I had something happen a while back that I didn't know what to do with. At the time, I didn't know there were places to report it to, and I wasn't even sure what it was when it happened. But within a few minutes after it was all over, I did know. I live in Washington State, and I spend my weekends exploring all that my beautiful state has to offer. One of the more spectacular sights in Washington is Mount Rainier. Now, just southwest of Mount Rainier is the High Rock Trail. It's one of my favorites, and I've done it many times. I love the challenges with the steep inclines, and I love the stunning views. On this day, as always, I took my dog Bandit with me. Bandit is a mixed breed of dog, but most people take one look at him, and they're sure he's a full-blooded German Shepherd. He is tan with a classic black saddle on him, and he has the sloped hips that a German Shepherd has. But what really matters is that he's a really good dog. He's saved me more than a few times in different ways. First, he's been my constant companion since my divorce. He also once stopped me from walking right up on a bear out on a trail. Now, I'd only had Bandit a couple of months, and this one day we were out hiking. Suddenly, Bandit starts acting all strange, and then he starts pulling on my pants and growling at me. It's like he was trying to pull me or stop me from walking. At first, I thought he was trying to play, but he was growling for real. I could not figure out what was going on. Then I got worried. Was he about to turn on me? But no, up ahead, I could hear a bear chuffing. I couldn't see it because of the curve of the trail. And it might not have been on the trail exactly, but it was close enough that Bandit smelled it, and he stopped me. And from that day forward, I have always trusted Bandit because of that bear. And that's what I thought was going on when what I'm about to tell you happened. Normally when we're out on the trails, Bandit will walk back and forth, and he has to stop and sniff every single leaf and every tree. He'll cross back and forth over the trail in front of me constantly. He might only be 6 to 10 feet ahead of me, and he always stays close. He was doing that when he suddenly stopped, and he looked off into the trees that went up the slope that ran along the trail. Bandit let out a short woof. It was about a quarter volume of a normal woof from him. I swear it was like he was trying to whisper to me or something. We were on the trail below Sawtooth Ridge, which I had had some other weird things happen on that ridge years before, and now I wonder if they aren't connected. But right then, on that day, I wasn't thinking about that. I stopped, and I looked up the slope to the ridge, just like Bandit was. Bandit stood rock solid and perfectly still. I could see his nose going a mile a second. I don't mean that he was sniffing loudly like a dog on a scent. I just saw that his nostrils were dancing like crazy, but his head never moved. Then Bandit's tail went down between his back legs, and he took a couple steps backwards towards me. I don't think I'd ever seen him do it like that. Then he turns, and he comes to stand right by my leg, and he presses into me very hard. Then he starts growling and barking like the most dangerous thing on earth is coming right at us. The first bark or two were normal yap-yap kind of warning barks. But then his barks and his growls took on that kind of edge that lets you know we're serious. He sounded like a wolf, and his lips were pulled back, and he was snapping his teeth while he was barking and growling. That took me off guard. In the 4 years I had owned Bandit, I had never seen that. This was not my Bandit. To my knowledge, there are no wolves in that area. I know there are mountain lions, bobcats, bears, and coyotes. But other than those, I didn't think there were any large, dangerous predators in that area. so I didn't know what had Bandit so upset. I quickly decided that it must be one of the cat species up there. But when I got home later, I thought back to another time that we did run into a bobcat, and Bandit didn't act like that. But that wasn't on my mind right then. A cat species threatening us from on the slope seemed like the most logical thing. I carry an M&P 9 9mm pistol for safety. I got it out and thumbed the safety off. I was expecting to see a flash of blonde as a mountain lion leaped out from the trees on the slope at us. I tried to get Bandit to move, one way or the other, up the trail, down the trail, I don't care, just move. But he wouldn't move. He was focused completely on the slope. His whole body had gone rigid, and the hair from between his shoulder blades up the back ruff of his neck was all bristled up. I'd never seen him like that either. That is where the phrase hackles raised came, I guess. I know better than to turn or run with a predator in the area. So I'm eyeballing the slope everywhere. I do better to face it. Now I'm starting to pick up on tiny sounds like rock or dirt sliding down the slope. It sounded exactly like something was coming down that slope and disturbing all the little stuff on the ground as it went along. Something was coming down from the ridge. Bandit's tail was between his legs and curled up under his belly. I looked down. My dog's eyes were wide with fear, and his teeth were bared. We both waited to see what it was. The sliding came closer, and I saw little stones go out onto the trail. So it was almost out of the trees, I thought. A few young saplings would move and jiggle as it came down, and I could track the movement down the slope just by watching those. I figured it was going to hit the trail roughly 30 feet from us. The last thing in the world that I expected is what it was. Stones and dirt spilled out onto the dirt trail. Then there was a large thump as this large creature hopped off the slope and onto the trail. I tell you, this creature was very tall, over 7 feet. I saw its width for just a second when it came out. Then I saw it from the side for another second as it crossed the trail and then went down the slope on the other side, which was also covered in trees. The whole thing was brief, but I'll never forget what I saw. I didn't feel it when it hopped out onto the trail, like people say, like a mini earthquake. But I did hear the impact on the dirt. It acted and looked just like a kid, you know, when they hop from the last step down to the road when they get off the school bus. I stood there speechless. I had never seen anything like it. Tall and wide-shouldered with lots of muscling. I could see those muscles as it walked. There was nothing fake there. And anyone hiding up there on the slope, if they were trying to punk me, they would have seen me get my gun out, and they would have surely called it quits. The hair covered everything that I saw, even the face. The hair was a dull brown and medium length. It only looked at us for maybe a second when Bandit barked at it again. It did not seem concerned at all with us. It just kept going in the same direction at the same speed, which was faster than a human's comfortable walking speed. Where we were, the trail was pretty narrow, so it only took one step for it to finish crossing the trail before heading down the slope. As its backside slipped away into the trees, I could see bits of leaves and who knows what all over its backside, almost as if it had sat down and tried to slide down the slope. But all of it happened so fast. I remember the turn when it looked at us. I saw the face, yes, but my clearest memory is the eyes. They were dark and under a brow that stuck out very far. Maybe if I had been closer, I might have seen an actual look on its face. You know, if it was annoyed at seeing us or angry. But I don't recall getting any impression of a look it had on its face. Once it crossed over and started going down the other slope, I could still hear it as it moved away. Bandit was still pressed to my side and growling low. I listened for maybe 3 or 4 seconds more, just long enough so that I knew it wasn't circling around or coming back. Then I picked Bandit up and physically turned him around on the trail, because no matter what, he would not move on his own. I had to tug a few times on his harness, but he quickly got the message that we were going to get out of there, and he was happy to comply. We quickly headed right back down to the main trailhead. It was like we were tiny gnats on the trail compared to that thing. Once the shock faded a bit, and maybe a couple hundred yards down the trail, I came up with the name for what I had just seen. Sasquatch. It was not interested in us, I don't think. It only looked our way because of Bandit. I wonder if it had any idea we were there at all. Surely it had heard Bandit. Yet it came on down the slope anyway. Aren't they supposed to be smart and able to smell people so they can avoid them? I mean, if so, then the one we saw had no F's left to give that day. It did not seem to care that it walked right in front of us. So does that mean that it knows humans are nothing to fear? Or was there another one nearby, waiting to attack as we watched the first one? I can't say. Bandit did not completely relax until we were in the car and drove away. Even then, that night and the next few nights, he seemed restless and more on guard when we went out for our evening walks, even though we were miles away from where it happened and stayed in our suburban area. This happened in May of 2019. I think I forgot to tell you that. Later that summer, I did decide to hike that trail again, because, as I said, it was one I always liked. How many times had I hiked it and never saw anything? Bandit, however, refused to go. Bandit was all happy when I started putting his little hiking backpack on his harness and I put him in the car. He was all tongue wagging and tail wagging. He knew what all of that meant. He was a happy pup until I pulled into the trailhead. Then he looked at me with that look of betrayal like I just pulled into the vet's office. He started whining and he tried to hide in the floorboard. We did not hike there that day. And as long as I have Bandit, I will never hike there again. I am not afraid to hike it myself again. I think if it wanted to do something to me and Bandit, well, I don't think that my pistol would have had sufficient stopping power. Maybe if I emptied the entire magazine, but I don't know how fast it moves. I don't know that I would have had enough time to do that. But it doesn't matter now, does it? The thing is, I saw one. I know they exist. I did try once to tell my story to some friends while we were out one night. Big mistake. It's true, alcohol does make you comfortable and it will loosen your tongue. And sometimes that can be really good. But not that night. Now, whenever I see any of them, I get asked things like, "Seen any leprechauns lately?" Or, "How many UFOs have you seen?" Because to them, if I think I've seen a Sasquatch, I'm right up there with the nuttiest people on earth. And that, Nance, is why I don't talk about it, and why I didn't report it, even when I did discover there were places to do so-called official reports. You know, it's just not worth my job. It isn't worth my ex preventing me from seeing my children. And she would, you know. You know she'd take this to a judge and say, he's not fit to be around the kids. You know, it's just not worth it. So don't use my name, please. Just sign me as Bandit's Human. Dear Nance, hi again from Tater. I have a short encounter for you. I work at a ski resort, and I've been learning to drive the snowcat to take supplies up to a restaurant halfway up the mountain. It's the only way we can take them up there. We start running the supplies up around 5 p.m., well after dark. On the way up with a load, I caught movement on the edge of the tree line. Thing is, no one is on the mountain, except for the groomers, and they're in snowcats. It was 20 degrees with 15-mile-per-hour winds. This person was on foot and would have been cold. By the time I got the spotlight to where they were, They were gone. There were no tracks, as the trail was firm from the grooming. 45 minutes later, I was heading down and caught movement in the trees. I swung the spotlight over where it was and saw an 8 to 9 foot shaggy figure walking away. I couldn't see any details because the spotlight wasn't very bright, but I saw hair swaying from its arms. The passenger asked what I was looking at, but I didn't say anything because there was nothing there for them to see, and I didn't want to look crazy, well, any more than normal. I just turned and finished the trip down. Thanks for reading my story. I hope I can ride my four-wheeler into Sasquatch Valley, weather permitting. I do not have much of a story to share, but I am glad to have a place to share it. Greetings, Nance and the Sasquad. It was early September 2020. My husband and I had finally decided that, even if the world collapsed in our absence, we had to take a few days for ourselves, away from work, the grown kids that are such a joy to have coming by but always seem to be present or on their way every day of the year, the critters we must care for, the vehicles that need maintenance or repair, the mailbox with all of its potential demands, and everything else that comes with leading a good but busy life in far northern California. We loaded the truck with camping gear and headed roughly northeast toward beautiful Iron Canyon Reservoir. I had just been camping there earlier in the summer with my grown daughter, if you can call 20 grown. It was with her and her two closest friends. I had not been invited on that trip, but the idea of three girls, as lovely as they all are, alone in the woods where no cell signal reaches, well, that had me feeling cold with fear. So despite their obvious reluctance to have me along, I climbed in the back of my daughter's car and tried to remain as unobtrusive as possible. Once at the campground, I found a spot from which I could not see their tent, but where I was certain that I would hear any cry for help. I hung my hammock between two huge pines and did my best to steer clear of the girls. I sincerely wanted only to protect them if it came to it. That first evening, just as it got dark, I walked down to the reservoir. In daylight, it is incredibly beautiful there. The water is clear and shallow enough at the edges that it is not too cold to endure. Also, there are rocks and sand on the bottom, rather than the awful, slimy whatever it is that so many lakes have. I strolled the bank for a ways and then waded out until I was almost waist deep. I just stood there looking at the stars in the sky and seeing them reflected in the water. I could hear laughter and talking from the campsites behind me. Once in a while I would hear a voice I recognized, raised in excited conversation, or letting out an unrestrained hoot of laughter. I was glad that I was there, knowing they were okay and having fun, instead of at home with tentacles of dread toying with the hair on the back of my neck, or reaching into my gut to torture me there. Then the water around me rippled. It was gentle, as though someone standing near me had taken a quick step. The little waves lapped against me as I tried to see what had stirred the water. I had heard no splash like a fish jumping. I crouched down to look at things with the sky as backdrop. Often it's easier to see objects in that way, since even on a moonless night, the sky is a bit lighter than any solid object. So, objects, including people, will stand out. Still, I could see nothing in the water with me. I was about to disregard those ripples and conclude that it had been a fish after all, when I distinctly heard a large something moving through the water, slowly. I say something, though I really had, nor have, much grounds for thinking it was anything other than a person. It sounded like a person. It just didn't feel like a person. And I was still unable to see anything, though the sound came from what seemed a short distance away. I said softly, "Hello?" But I got no answer. The something had stopped moving, but the water had not yet settled, and that's when I suddenly felt frightened to the bone. No one knew that I was in the water. No one would think to look to see where I was, perhaps until late morning tomorrow. What a fool I was. I began to ease backward toward the shore, keeping low so as not to create much of a silhouette myself against the sky. And who or whatever was there followed me just as slowly. I heard it, and the waves lapped at me as I fled at a snail's pace. When I could no longer remain crouched because the water had gotten too shallow, I turned and I hot-footed it back to the campground. I did not look back, and the noise I made covered any noise that might have come from the water. I was still very frightened when I came upon my daughter and her friends engaged in a very entertaining attempt to haul their bags of groceries up into a tree in case of bears. I stopped to help them, and I forgot all about whatever had been in the water with me, sharing the starlight. For 2 nights I slept in my hammock, out of sight from the other campers, and I never thought about my erstwhile companion again. I slept like a rock both nights. I likely would never have even recalled the episode at all, except for the events that took place when my husband and I returned to Iron Canyon that following September, looking for some peace and an escape from the stress. My husband says that I always take forever to do anything. I say he's always in a hurry, rushing me unreasonably. He may have the more solid position in the argument, because it's not all that uncommon for us to leave for errands, trips to town, or even much-anticipated vacations much later than planned. And this trip was no exception. When we turned onto the road that runs around Iron Canyon Reservoir, and then again onto the road leading to the campgrounds, it was quite dark. I guess it may have been nearly midnight. We had meant to arrive at about 5 p.m. Well, everyone has their shortcomings, right? Mine is a tendency to dawdle just a little. I could have worse flaws. You might think that with all of those extra hours that we had spent, one of us might have taken a minute to be sure that the campgrounds were open. But we hadn't even thought of it. Perhaps you are not aware of the nemesis that haunts Northern California nearly every year, beginning in midsummer, sometimes earlier, and often lingering into autumn. It's the wildfire. Wildfires trouble many states, of course, but we seem to have more than our fair share, and the damage they do seems to increase all the time. It should have occurred to us that with fires burning all over the North State, and the risk of igniting more so high, that of course camping would not be allowed. Sure enough, the gates to the campground were shut and locked. A sign had been hung on them explaining that due to the existing fires and the high fire danger, camping was prohibited. Now what? We stood beside the flatbed of the truck, staring out into the night. It was a long way back to anywhere that might have a motel. It was an even longer way back home, and that was almost the last place we wanted to go anyway. We were tired from the drive, and we didn't want to get back into the truck and to keep driving. It sounded like such a miserable thing to do. We were just toying with the idea of spreading our bedding in the flatbed and just getting some rest before moving on. It seemed like the best and likely the safest plan. We would make no fire nor do anything which could cause a spark. We would rest just a few hours, and then think what was best when our heads were clearer. Out of the dark woods, in front and slightly to the left of us, came a scream I have no way to describe. It sounded like nothing I have ever heard, ever. It was so loud, it seemed unreal. It was not very long and did not really change in pitch. It was the most aggressive sound I have ever heard. Thankfully, it was coming from a decent distance away. Maybe the length of a city block? I had been in the process of writing a text to my daughter, describing our ill luck. But it could not be sent until we had a signal. But I was preparing it anyway. So, when we heard the second scream, virtually identical to the first, but this time coming from our right side, I opened my camera app and I started recording video. I knew it was too dark, but at least I could catch that scream if it happened again. And it did. Seconds later, again from the left came a third scream. Closer now. Much closer. My husband said only, "Let's go." And that was my opinion as well. We jumped in the truck, I locked my door, and we made a quick 3-point turn, and we were gone. My husband grew up in the mountains around there. As kids, he and his sister and brother ran wild all over and all through that land. They hunted, camped, built forts, rode horses, and did everything kids do for years around there. He knew enough not to take me out into the woods unarmed. I don't shoot firearms, but my husband is an excellent marksman. He was armed that night with a shotgun and a .44 revolver. When we talked about what we had heard later, he said that in all the time he had spent in that area, he had come to know the sound of every animal. Bears, mountain lions, and all of the smaller beasts. He still maintains that he has never heard anything even similar to those screams. He told me something else that had me sick with belated horror. He said that he had decided to go so quickly because he heard something that I had not. He said that he could hear the sound of the screamer on the left, running towards us. He said that he could tell from the sound of its footfalls that he did not have a weapon that would be enough to take it down, and that whatever it was, there were two of them. My guess? They were glad to be free of campers, and they were out, enjoying the peaceful night. And then we came with our lights and our noise, and we spoiled it. And they were not happy with us at all, and it showed. Were they connected in any way with my companion in the water just a few months before? I have nothing but a gut feeling that tells me yes. What were they? Well, my husband and I reached the same conclusion independently. We think they were Sasquatch. We can think of nothing else that might make such sounds or cause such bone-deep terror. And what about my recording? Yes, I still have it, and I will send it to you if you like. But the scream that was nearly deafening when we heard it sounds in the recording like someone exhaling loudly. No voice, no tone or pitch, just a rush of air. I have no way to explain it. I can't even drum up a decent theory. I once had a neighbor who had two huge guard dogs. He had their vocal cords cut so that when they barked, there was no noise. It was just an eerie rush of breath. That's what my recording sounds like. But in person? In person, these things have vocal cords. Nice, big, strong vocal cords. So why did only the rush of air record? Probably something like the reason I could not see anyone in the water with me. Maybe. I know there's an answer. I just can't imagine what it could be. I am sorry that I am unable to tell a story with a more satisfying end. I wish I had seen what was there. But I feel better for having gotten it all out. I have described the two events before, but never as one story. Maybe they have no connection. I think they do. Thank you for what you do. We listen every night. If we can't find a new episode, we listen to an older one. I think it's important to note, however, that we have never listened to any Bigfoot stories until after these events. Take care, Nance. Take care, Sasquatch. I want them to be gentle and friendly, but I am very much afraid they are not. Go carefully and be wise. Cheers. Signed, Patience. Now, just a note for everyone. Patience actually sent this in back in November. I contacted her and told her I would love to have that recording of the scream they heard. She has been looking for it. You know how it is. You put something on a hard drive, or you change computers, or you get it off your phone and you put it on a USB. But which one and where is it? I mean, we've all done it, right? So when she does find it, she will send it to me. I just want to let you know. I didn't want to wait on this story much longer. I really, really liked that set of encounters. So Patience, when you do find it, please send it in. All right, everyone, real quick, I do have just a couple little bitty things. One thing, if you can do for me, if you look on my channel page or as you're watching this video, if you check and see that box where it says subscribed, will you do me a favor and make sure that the little bell icon next to the word subscribed is white or at least getting custom notification? Here's what I've noticed on several other channels that I subscribe to. That bell now has a slash through it, or it's been turned off completely. I get no notifications. I go back, I hit get notifications. 2 days later, I am no longer getting notifications. I mention this because recently I've had several listeners tell me they weren't getting any notification at all about my new videos coming out. And so they were having to come and physically look for them. So if you aren't seeing me in your feed, if you're not getting notifications, make sure that bell is clicked. I'm not sure what's happening. I think something is happening in the background at YouTube. Like, I think they're making improvements. They're doing things, but I think, you know how it is. It's like whack-a-mole. You fix one thing and two other things break. That's just how I think it is. So just please be sure to do that, and do that for everybody you're subscribed to. Every time you go to their channel or see their video, make sure of it. It's just a simple way to make sure you know when something new comes out. All right, everyone. I know Tuesday I mentioned that Yeti Bars now has their Pebbles line, which is really, really cool. They say it smells like cereal. It is live. You can actually go get the new Yeti Pebbles bar. I've got a link here for you in the video description below. And that's what it looks like. It looks pretty cool. And if you haven't seen the video of them pouring it, go check them out at yetibars.net. And as always, if you place an order through Yeti Bars, be sure to use the code BB10 and you will get 10% off your entire order. So even if you order things on sale, they compound it and give you that 10% off on top of the sale price. All right, everyone. Listen, I've nattered on enough. We'll be getting together again real soon. And until then, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening.